fossils from an extinct Homo erectus population have been found in Madura Strait in Indonesia. Recent archaeological finds from the seabed of the Madura Strait, separating the Indonesian islands of Java and Madura, have yielded valuable insights into the existence of Homo erectus approximately 140,000 years ago. Now let's get into the story, into this AI podcast.
Okay, trying to picture this for a second. Not, you know, ruins on land, but an entire world, a whole landscape, actually underwater.
Yeah, deep underwater. Mm-hmm. We're talking about the Madura Strait off Indonesia's coast. An incredible discovery.
And it's not just any old landscape, right? It's packed with history. They found fossilized bones.
Thousands of them. Animal bones, yes, but also Homo erectus, our ancient human ancestors.
Homo erectus, under the sea.
Uh-huh. Dating back maybe 140,000 years. It's like finding a whole lost world, a forgotten chapter of our evolution.
A lost world. That's exactly what it feels like. So this information comes from recent scientific work, detailed in excerpts from Sundaland's Submerged Homo Erectus World.
Right.
And that's our mission for this deep dive. Really unpack what they found, what this lost world Sundaland, they call it, was actually like, and what it means for how we understand human history.
It really is an amazing story. And, you know, the way it was found makes it even more intriguing. It wasn't like some planned dig.
No, completely accidental. Happened back in 2011, I think. Sand miners working near Surabaya.
Exactly. They were dredging, you know, pulling up sediment for a land reclamation project.
And they just started seeing bones.
Yeah, tons of them. A huge pile of fossilized animal bones and mixed right in fragments of human skulls. Luckily, someone realized, hang on, this is important.
Thank goodness they did, because then the real science could start. And figuring out the age, well, that must have been the first big step.
Absolutely crucial. And the age, over 140,000 years old, immediately points to a very different world map. Because that spot, it used to be dry land.
Pardon this, Sundaland.
Precisely. This massive, now submerged continent, or maybe better described as a vast exposed continental shelf.
Sundaland, it sounds epic. What are we talking about size-wise? What did it look like back then?
Oh, it was immense. Imagine a huge tropical plain connecting mainland Southeast Asia with islands like Java, Borneo, Sumatra, modern-day Indonesia, Malaysia, parts of Thailand, Vietnam.
Wow, how is that possible?
Well, during the last ice age, huge amounts of Earth's water were locked up in glaciers and ice sheets, so sea levels were much, much lower.
How much lower?
Over 120 meters lower than today. That exposed this vast area of land.
So not just a little land bridge, but a whole continent-sized area.
Exactly. A sprawling, low-lying landscape. Think big rivers snaking across it, maybe dense forests in places, open woodlands or savanna in others, teeming with wildlife.
An incredible ecosystem.
Absolutely. Perfect for large animals, and as we now know for sure, perfect for ancient humans too.
But then it vanished. The ice melted.
That's the story. Starting around, say, 14,000 years ago, the planet warmed up, the glaciers melted, pouring water back into the oceans.
And the sea levels rose.
Dramatically. Over several thousand years, up to about 7,000 years ago, the rising water just crept across Sundaland, drowning it, creating the islands we see today.
And somehow, evidence from that drowned world survived all that time underwater. So tell us about the science after the miners raised the alarm.
Okay, so once scientists got involved, a proper investigation kicked off. The sources mention archaeologist Harold Berkowitz from Leiden University taking a leading role, and they needed some pretty sophisticated techniques to figure out the age, not just of the bones, but the sediment layer they were buried in.
Which brings us to OSL dating, optically stimulated luminescence.
Exactly. OSL is really clever. It can basically tell you the last time grains of sand or silt were exposed to sunlight. So by dating the sediment the fossils were found in, you get the age of when everything was buried.
And what did the OSL results show?
They pinned it down quite nicely. The sediment layer, and therefore the fossils within it, were deposited sometime between 162,000 and 119,000 years ago.
Which is the late Middle Pleistocene, a really interesting time for human evolution.
A very dynamic period, yeah. Lots of movement, lots of different hominin forms around. Then, of course, they had to identify the human bits.
How definite were they? How did they know it was Homo erectus?
Well, they had two really good skull fragments. A piece of the frontal bone, the forehead area, and a parietal bone from the side. They did really detailed analysis, comparing the shape, the thickness, all the anatomical features with known Homo erectus fossils, especially ones from nearby Java, like the Sambong Makan site.
And it was a match.
A solid match. close enough to confidently say, yes, this is Homo erectus.
Finding Homo erectus there specifically in this now underwater part of Sundaland, why is that such a big deal?
Well, this really changes things. See, for a long time, most of what we knew about Homo erectus in this part of the world came from finds on Java.
Right, the famous Java man finds.
Exactly. So we knew they were on Java. But finding them here, out on what was the Sunda shelf, gives us direct physical proof they were roaming this much larger landmass.
So they weren't just isolated on islands that hadn't quite become islands yet.
Precisely. It pushes their known range way out. It means we have to imagine them living and moving across this vast, low-lying tropical world that connected everything.
That really paints a different picture of their lives.
It does. It gives us clues about, you know, how mobile they were, how they adapted to different kinds of environments within Sundaland, how they survived.
And they weren't alone out there. The animal fossils, over 6,000 bones, 36 species. That's a lot.
It's an incredible snapshot of the whole ecosystem. It tells us so much about the world Homo erectus inhabited, the food available, the other creatures they shared the landscape with.
What kind of animals are we talking about? Anything particularly stand out?
Oh, definitely. One of the stars was Stegodon, these giant extinct relatives of elephants.
Giant? How giant?
Huge. Maybe up to 13 feet tall at the shoulder, weighing over 10 tons. Just massive animals. Okay. And the teeth they found actually show a specific evolutionary stage for Stegodon in that region.
Wow. Okay, giant elephants.
Yeah.
What else was roaming around?
Lots of deer. Several different species, actually, which suggests, you know, a mix of habitats, probably open woodlands, maybe some grassy areas.
Mm.
Deer would have been a really important food source.
Makes sense.
And they also found Komodo dragons. Yes, those giant lizards. Buffalo. Animals that were a bit like antelope, other big vertebrates. A really rich fauna.
A proper prehistoric safari park, almost. And you mentioned something about the animal bones themselves suggesting human activity.
Yes, this is really significant. Many of the animal bones had clear-cut marks on them. Deliberate marks made by tools.
Not just random scratches.
No, these look like butchery marks. Signs that Homo erectus was systematically processing these carcasses, cutting meat off the bone.
So not just scavenging leftovers, but actively hunting and processing these large animals.
The evidence strongly points that way. It shows pretty advanced behavior, tool use, and hunting skills. Right there in that Sundaland environment.
Amazing. They were really thriving. And the location itself, geologically speaking, there was something about a river.
Right. The site wasn't just some random spot on the plain. The researchers figured out it was located within an ancient buried river valley.
Part of a major river system.
Yeah, part of the ancient Solo River. Back then, the Solo River didn't flow south into the Indian Ocean like it does from Java today. It flowed eastward. Right across Sundaland.
Okay, so a big river running through their territory. That must have been important.
Hugely important. The sediments show it was a healthy river ecosystem. Think about it. Fresh water, fish, other animals drawn to the water, and probably a natural corridor for movement, a highway across the landscape for both animals and people.
It likely anchored their whole existence in that area.
Very likely. It makes sense that they'd be concentrated near such a vital resource.
So pulling all this together, what's the big takeaway? How does this discovery shift our understanding of human history, of Homo erectus?
Well, first, it just blows up the old maps of where we thought Homo erectus lived in Southeast Asia. We now know for sure they were successfully inhabiting this vast submerged continent.
It shows their reach was much wider.
Much wider.
Yeah.
And it also gives us this incredible case study in how our ancestors dealt with massive environmental change.
You mean the rising sea levels?
Exactly. They lived and thrived in this landscape for potentially tens of thousands of years, a landscape that was ultimately fundamentally transformed and then lost to the sea. It speaks volumes about their adaptability.
Their resilience?
Yeah, resilience, adaptability, navigating complex, changing environments. It's a powerful story.
And it really highlights the potential of these underwater sites, doesn't it?
Absolutely. Harold Bergwies, the lead archaeologist, is quoted saying something like, "This whole period was marked by great diversity and mobility of hominins in the region. This find is proof of that mobility."
And now we have the technology to look.
You do. Modern marine tech sonar mapping, taking sediment cores, even underwater excavation, lets us explore these drowned landscapes in ways unimaginable before. These places aren't necessarily lost forever.
Which brings us to a pretty profound final thought.
Yeah, the idea that this amazing find in the Madura Strait, it might just be scratching the surface.
The tip of the iceberg, so to speak.
Exactly. Many scientists think there's likely much more evidence of prehistoric life, maybe even tools, campsites, who knows, lying preserved beneath the shallow seas of Southeast Asia.
Because as the waters rose, people would have had to move, retreat, leaving things behind.
Their homes, their tools, maybe sacred sites, all submerged. These sunken memories, as the source material calls them, entire landscapes, entire histories, just waiting.
It really makes you wonder how much of our ancient story, humanity's journey, is still down there, hidden beneath the waves.
What other lost worlds are out there? What other discoveries could completely reshape our understanding of where we came from? It's a reminder that our planet's history, and our own history within it, is incredibly dynamic, and sometimes large parts of it just disappear from view, waiting to be rediscovered.
Who was Homo Erectus, and what makes this discovery in the Madura Strait important for understanding this species? Don't forget to comment it. Thanks.